session, meeting 7 o'clock. And we are being broadcast Comcast Channel 89 or Verizon Channel number 32. And it's being recorded by RCTV. And you can check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. Our first item on the agenda is the continuation of 1260 to 1264 Main Street, map 45, lot 104 and 106. They want to continue till April 12th. And we need a site walk. Chuck sent out a form. Okay, what week was that? April, the first week of April, right?
First week of April.
April 3rd through the 6th.
Right, and
I can't do that on, and it's from 8 o'clock to 12 o'clock. I think we only need an hour.
Does it look like, although, Harry, what day couldn't you make? Wednesday?
No.
It was Wednesday. So Tuesday and Thursday were the ones that
I can make.
Filled up.
Yeah. And you guys can, I thought you guys could make all of them, right?
Well, just book it in, and I can't tell, so if I can get there, I'll scoot over whatever you guys decide.
Dave, were you unavailable for one?
I was on the 4th.
Which is a Tuesday.
Tuesday. I can't do the 4th.
What about Thursday?
I'm good on the 4th. Sixth, sorry. Yeah, I can do the 6th.
I don't remember. that's what those boxes were for.
I know. I
saw you for Monday and
Wednesday was the
Mike, can you call it up on your phone? I sent the latest with Becky's reply.
And his
back
and
I without an iPad these days.
Did it
budget cuts. So I can't do Thursday. That was the only day.
So what day looks good? If we can choose one now, I can get back to the I can get back to the well scientist.
That's why you get the big bucks.
Wait, so
pick one.
I get the big bucks, you're right.
I thought you said you could do Tuesday?
I can do Tuesday.
Okay.
I don't think
Dave can't do Tuesday.
I can't
Dave.
Do Tuesday.
And
I
could
do
it
in the afternoon,
but
I can't
do
it
between
8
and 12, but now she can do it between 8 and 2. Right?
Yeah, school hours.
Yeah.
No.
But I didn't see what ones you want. Oh, you were on the first one already.
I prefer any day but Wednesday. But Wednesday
if you can do like 12.
So it's only Thursday or
Tuesday.
Tuesday.
It's just me. I would rather have you out there than.
I can do Tuesday, like if it's in the afternoon. My appointment's at 10 in the morning, so I'll be out by 11:30.
Can everyone do Tuesday at 1?
Yes.
Sure.
Tuesday?
Well, yeah, what about you? This was one we were trying to get you involved in, and it's something like 8 o'clock in the morning would have been great,
Roma?
Right?
Yeah. I'll just work from home, and the more notice you give me, the better chance I can block it off and be there.
It's the 12th of April, so.
April 12th.
2 weeks.
What time?
We're
this
still,
one is
we're still
April
on.
4th.
April 4th.
Yep. So April 12th at 10 is 44 Roma.
Sorry. So
1260. No, that's 1260, 1261 Main Street.
April 4th at 1.
At 1 o'clock. Okay. At 1 p.m.
At 1.
Okay. The other thing you guys could do right now would be to look over the minutes I just put out. Everyone has minutes in front of them.
This.
And that's it, yeah. It's also underneath that other piece there. And, I'm trying to knock off some of these minutes.
Okay.
So if you just look those over.
So we still have Amy Shikatani on our.
We do.
Member.
She's still a member.
Any chance she's gonna start attending?
I think she was. I think her term's coming up, and I think the clerk contacted her, and I was kind of leaving it up to the clerk to make the first.
Is it a 1 year? It's a 2 year term, right? 3 year term.
Three, yeah. Unless you get into a term that someone else already had.
Oh, is that what she did? So she was. She only had 8. Cause she's only been on it for about a year.
Spelled John LaRusso incorrectly.
LaRusso.
It's on the last page, not on the side.
Yeah, it's all one word. Yeah, LaRusso.
See, I don't think I saw the last application, so I don't know that I said it was an improvement. I think I probably said it was an improvement to
where you're at.
LaRusso.
Yeah, I'll go with that first.
Did you get that, Chuck?
You did say it.
I think I said to the wetlands.
You said something
like that. Not to the
like
application.
That. You said something. Yeah. What did you say? But something was an improvement. I remember you saying this is an improvement.
To the current wetland.
Okay.
I think is what.
Mrs. Flynn said it was an improvement to the current wetlands. Okay, that's a great correction. That's exactly what we wanted to do.
Should I mention the typo of my name?
Mention everything, especially if you don't have... autocorrect.
The motion for low meta on the back page.
Back page.
One end. Well, only two ends in Scanlon. No double end.
I abstained. So yeah. I think the numbers must be wrong.
That's what my notes say. I didn't review the tape, but I was also confused.
Well,
and hope you could add.
I would assume I didn't abstain, or else we wouldn't have had a. So it was 4-1.
Was it 5-0-1? I mean
5-0-1. I might have abstained because I wasn't at the meeting. I think the meeting before this, I wasn't there.
So there were two.
You're talking about
Low Meadow.
You're talking about you abstained. Yeah, I was wondering.
I think I abstained because I wasn't there.
So it could have been. It could have been
on Low Meadow, or did I mess that up? It was on Hunt.
Oh. So the motion to close could have been 4-0.
I'll check that on the video.
Zero, right?
I can't.
If Mike, it would be 4-0-1, not 4-1-0.
Yep.
So is that the same as the Red Ring Rifle and Revolver? 4-0-1?
Yes, because I abstained on that. So it would be 4-0-1.
Did you get LaRusso? L-O-R-U-S-S-O.
Yeah, I'll...
Okay.
I have it written somewhere else.
Chuck, are you sure about the meeting date? Is this the last meeting we had? No, 2 meetings ago?
This was more than 2 meetings ago.
This is more. This is January 25th.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm just trying to...
Strawberry Hill here. And they continue.
They're on at 7:20.
7:10.
Well, that's it. This is the one that you were absent for, and
which
I chaired.
Which was February vacation.
Right. That's the thing. I think the date is actually.
This is January 25th.
It wasn't
was wrong.
January 25th.
No, because I wasn't. I would have been here, but I wasn't here in February. The February vacation.
February 22.
Oh, you're talking at the top. I didn't change that. Sorry, that's.
That's the thing. I'm trying to go back through my minute notes here.
Right.
So it was February 22.
Yeah.
Because I could check some of these. I wrote a couple of votes down.
Anna Better.
Anna Better.
I need to look at her, look up her name. That's why I highlighted it.
Resident.
Yeah, she made that comment.
Oh, I thought it said, Anna Better ask why the commission hasn't pushed back. I'm a very literal person.
Anna Better do that.
That should be in a butter, right?
Oh,
in a butter.
Good play.
I get her name. Let me tell you, that Anna Butter, she has a lot of meetings.
Is she related to Mrs. Butterworth?
Second.
If you want to send me something, Harry.
I'm just doing it now. It's just little stuff.
Sure. We can approve a couple of
bills.
What do we got there?
MACC conference.
Yeah, we have a bill from the MACC conference. $345. I have an invoice from Anika for $145. So that needs to be changed, but I did. They will send me one with the total, and the total verbally from MACC is $345. So I'd like an approval to pay that bill when I receive it for $345 for the three people that went to the conference for $150.
I move we approve that bill.
Second.
All those in favor?
I have a second bill here from the Reading Water and Sewer bill for $13.14 for the
Pearl Street?
Yeah, for the Pearl Street parking area. Yeah.
I move we approve that.
Second.
All those in favor? Well, it's 7:14 in Strawberry Hill Lane. We haven't heard anything from them.
I haven't heard anything from Jack since.
I thought we were going to schedule a site visit.
No, I don't recall that.
Yeah.
Does anybody else recall that?
I don't remember.
I remember.
So, there's 14 Strawberry Hill.
I thought I suggested it, so that's why.
I'm sorry. I ignored that.
I have some recollection of that.
I thought, you know, one of the things we said is just once they have a plan to, well, we wanted to see what they wanted, a plan they wanted to put together,
great.
But. We were supposed to have a site visit before the last meeting, but it didn't get on the agenda until late, and I don't think anybody ever went.
Right.
So one of the things I recommend is to just all get out there that we all
see. I guess my question is,
but they need to have a plan.
What are we going to see?
Well,
we're going to see cleared land back there. I thought that was pretty obvious.
I'd like to see that wall.
That wall looks like it was what was in the middle of that lot, like halfway between the bottom and the top of the hill, that they just took all those stones and rolled them down onto the lot line. This is one of the historical pictures showed kind of in the middle of that lot, there was like a stone wall, and it looked like they just took that and the other stones that were there and rolled them down.
Remember Mrs. D'Angelo came in, I do, and the last time, and I think you were on the commission.
I was.
I don't think I remember seeing it when we approved the extension.
Didn't we go out to the site?
Yeah.
I remember because Chuck pointed out to me and said, this wasn't on there. This must be a changed plan. And I think we...
And it was that stone wall, right?
Yeah. And
the stone wall was...
I think we had stated in the... when we had extended the application at that time that if you... we want to see that this is moving. We want to see what is now being proposed because things are going to be different. Things are clearly occurring differently. We wanted to see movement. And then, obviously, we're where we're at today. So.
Well, and then we extended.
So where did that language get in, Mike? Was that written down?
This was, no. I mean, this was for an extension.
Just sent it to her.
Yeah.
And then she sold it.
Yeah. Sold us the bill of goods of she wanted to do something.
And then I think builders did clear cut it. Now you're saying that the stone wall got dismantled and moved to the back?
I think the wall was already there. The wall was there.
The wall was there
when we did the site walk.
Yeah.
I thought so.
The pictures are dated. So
right.
It almost seemed to me as I was looking at the pictures and looking at, you know, what's there now, it was clear that somewhere between when the people from NBA Builders picked it up and the other people left, you know, that vegetation in the wall was in place.
So the wall was built, though, I think we determined from the pictures, the wall was built sometime between October 2010, because that was the behind-the-scenes picture of the grass, of the tree. Do we have
a rough idea of what the time frame was?
2010.
Because the order of conditions was 2009.
I don't really care. I figured we should try to do it.
We have a quorum. We're fine. We can talk about it.
I mean,
Public meeting.
This is a meeting. I suppose I should have read the notice of intent. Open meeting.
Well, maybe we're just not talking. If they're not going to show up and we're going to continue it, maybe we'll just wait till they show up.
It's 7:19.
No,
we can wait a minute.
They would have shown up.
Well, I think Chuck would have heard from Jack.
I mean, we can take down some questions. I can write down some questions and send them to Jack. I haven't heard from Jack. I haven't, you know,
well,
Jack's
so
got.
I think it's beyond Jack.
Jack's got some work at one of another project we have that's. You know, might be taking up all of his time. I'm not sure.
I think it's beyond Jack right now. I think that couple was here. I would say that they haven't taken title to that property yet. I would say it's the contractor.
That's the question.
Responsible for that order of conditions.
Well, that's all. I heard exactly the opposite. I mean, as I talked to
the
builders.
The house isn't built. Well, they could have bought the property.
Yeah.
Well,
he
hired
the
contractor.
Yeah,
I thought they said they bought the land.
The woman said that
she
bought the property.
Did she say she
property.
Bought it?
I think
yes.
So. Yeah. She
I asked him the last meeting.
And then he said, did you know there were conditions recorded on this property? Remember, and the book she said, oh, the lawyer didn't point it out to me.
Right. Oh, yeah, I was under the impression that the contractor was building and hadn't sold it to them yet. That, yeah, maybe they bought it and hired that contractor.
I think they bought
it. So they're on the hook, you think?
Yeah, the chain of title has moved.
Right.
The current owner
is responsible for the order.
The current builders, well, I'm not even sure. I mean, the way whoever owns the property is responsible
that's
for
right.
the 2,700 square feet.
That's right.
And that's, I mean, that's where it's at. But I would think it's such kind of, you know, I don't think that NBA would, if they're not even off the property yet, they would have to replant it. I mean, I did tell them that. I said, you know,
well, somebody's
if,
gonna
if
have
the
to.
Pool wasn't going in, 2,700 square feet of vegetation would be going in somewhere on that property.
Well, it's obviously the current owner, and if that's the couple that was here, then they're responsible. But I would like to see, obviously, I don't think they did it. you know, if the contractor owned it for a few months, cleared the lot, and then sold it to somebody trying to build a house for them, they would have been responsible. If the homeowners bought this, and they didn't realize that, they're still responsible, I think.
I think they got some good feedback. I think they got some good feedback from both the commission and the residents. I think they're probably going to use that to readjust and figure out what they think they need
to
do. Yeah.
Because Jack said that he wanted to postpone, he didn't want to withdraw.
Yep.
Yes.
Let me ask the members of the commission, do you want another site visit?
If Jack's coming in with a new plan, yes. I want to make sure we do a site visit.
I'd like to see what they come up with first, though.
Yeah, I don't want to go out
there's
there.
Too many balls in the air.
So a site visit after the next meeting that 14 Strawberry Hill attends.
Or even if he comes with a revised plan that's easy enough to read on paper, we can go out and take a look and see how it matches up before the next meeting.
Do I have a motion to continue?
Can I propose that a site visit happen before the next meeting if they want to be heard at the next meeting?
Yes.
Not after the next meeting?
Only. And it has nothing to do with the plan? You just want to be out there and look at the current state of the building?
I myself was not able to get out to some of those site visits, and
if we don't have a new plan, you can just go out there anytime. It's open, walkable. You know the guys from MBA.
And there's a notice of intent on there right now.
Notice of intent, yeah.
Okay, we have the right.
And when we went out there last fall, it looked like a moonscape.
Yeah, it's cleared from.
I've driven by.
Wait, so David, you were on the commission when that? We were on the commission when we did that.
I don't remember that.
Yeah. We went out there on a Sunday morning in September, I think.
Okay, then.
We looked at it and said, yeah, take those two trees down. Okay, and then left.
Oh. I'm forgetting
trees.
That there was that.
Yes, a couple cars that day.
I wasn't at that one. I was at the one before
that.
I'm thinking of this deck. Yeah.
Minor plan change.
Yeah, okay. I'm sorry.
That was for the extension.
Yeah. No.
Is there a motion to continuing without the applicant's permission?
You don't need the applicant's permission to continue. It's a permit they've opened that we're just talking about.
Generally, the applicants.
They can only request that we close.
Well, they could deny an extension. If we said, did you want
to
continue?
They can do anything, but they have to be here.
But they have to be here to do
that. I know.
So
I was just thinking.
They can disagree to the continuing.
Yeah, if they were here, they could say we don't want to continue. We'd like you to close. But since they're not here, and that we didn't,
they
didn't say that, then we can just continue.
I'm surprised you didn't hear from Jack that they weren't coming.
Very surprised myself. I was so busy, I completely forgot about it. And then I did ask Anika, I said, you know, just remind me of what we're looking for from 14 Strawberry Hill. And she said, Jack's going to propose, Jack's going to come back with some answers and to propose a new plan.
I think it was challenged with finding a way to propose something that still meets the existing order of conditions.
Well,
that was his challenge.
He must still be working on it.
So, do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to continue.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Wow.
Shortest meeting on record, definitely.
Until old new
business.
Yeah, we can make this long if you want. We can make this long if you want.
Let's not.
Go for hours.
Run down the store. Six pack, I'll hang around here till 2.
People might still show up. It's, you know.
We have an order of conditions for 364 Lowell Street. Have you looked at this?
I need to look at this.
Okay. There are a lot of things. And I started looking at it, Dave started looking at it. I propose that we spend a bit more time going through this, make sure that we have everything we need to cover in this order of conditions. So,
what's the deal with the engineering and the TSS and...
That's still up in the air.
It's still up in the air.
Yeah.
Right.
They don't know if they've made the 80% total suspended solids removal.
So, I mean, just with that alone, why would we give them...
Who came up with that? Ryan? Ryan's review caught that? Is that what happened? They didn't get the 85?
No, Ryan hasn't been... Ryan reviewed it. You know, the plans... You know, the plans are kind of hard. They're cryptic, to say the least. And there's no detail on some of the stuff. But that's what Ryan needs to review. And he looked at it, and he had questions. And almost a month ago, he sent out questions. So my memo that they answered all those questions on, Ryan was supposed to have one in the very same day. So, you know, that was a memo to the applicant, and all the departments needed to write something up. So Ryan is still waiting for the answers from his, from back in January, or February.
And we need to see that before it finalizes.
No, we just need, we just need to know that Ryan has agreed that this is getting 80%.
Is satisfied with
the design. Yeah, so in the order, it's just written kind of clumsily right now.
Okay.
But it's going to be written that Ryan will approve before we're signing off on the application or the building permit.
Yeah.
We just need to know that.
And this is the four bay catching 80%?
Yeah. Now, I'm not sure that it doesn't, but...
But that design spec was vague. It was just said sediment four bay.
It was hard to follow. Yeah. And so what he said was everything's going to either be in that 500-gallon pretreatment area or the sediment area. And it should stay there, and that's why there's no outfall or no splash pad or anything like that. They have this one little spot where it's about an inch lower than everything else. And so Ryan was reviewing that, and he just said, you know, I really need more time, and I need to have somebody to ask some questions to. And on top of all this, the applicant's engineer had some surgery, and he wasn't available last 2 weeks, which has complicated things.
So we don't have any representatives here, and
Well, I did tell them I did get an email and didn't know about how no one would be showing up. I almost want to check what if we're in the right room, but I did tell them that 7:45 would be fine to show up, figuring that we would be talking to Strawberry Hill for a little bit of time.
Oh,
so you
okay.
Owe him at least till 7:45.
Okay. But I think that we will be telling them that we need more time to review this. Dave had some questions.
There was just one other question I didn't bring up to you. It was the thing I had mentioned before about the machine. We talked a couple of times about using a small mini excavator with rubber track.
Yeah.
And then also using a large excavator for large limbs or trees or anything like that. That's not in the order of conditions. And I know that was something that was brought up. It's even in the minutes that are here.
Where are we using this machinery?
To get the
water
material.
Course?
Yeah,
yeah, the
out
material.
Of the water course. And it
doesn't mention a large or small machine and talking about tires and,
right.
And that kind of stuff. It's not. But it does say they need to stay on the dry land and reach in
okay.
And pluck things out.
So
that is in it.
You don't really specify size or type of machine that just that...
I mean, I didn't have enough
if
expertise
it stays
to
out,
know
do we
what
care?
Was
out
there.
Right.
Yeah.
He said he's going to do
bigger
as much as
longer
possible
reasonable
by hand.
Anyway.
Right.
That's in there too.
Yeah.
We've asked
right.
them
yeah.
to... I mean, he certainly has the option, but the option for us is we allowed them to use by hand all the way up to reaching in with whatever machinery, you know, because that's going to help out a lot.
Just want a giant backhoe.
But that has to also be part of the plans that he submits to you before he starts the work anyway.
Yeah, those plans are going to have to really be on top of.
Right.
And it's it's like the last line of defense to ask for these changes, you know, just before the permit sign.
Should we say that they can only use, or does it say that the machine can only be used to remove the historic fill? Or did we say anywhere along the water course?
I'm saying that they can do it anywhere along the water course. I don't know what's going to be in there.
Because they were also going to use that machinery to pull out large obstructing limbs.
So wrap a chain around a tree that's down.
Yeah. And use it as leverage.
Well, I think the point is that we're not ready. No one's reviewed the order of conditions. We've started.
But.
Yeah.
But could that not be included in the order of condition, but be included in the plan for removal of the debris that they give you prior to starting the process?
Anything can be prior to it. It's just harder to make sure you get them. Because that's when all the planning boards come in and say, you know, why aren't you signing? I mean, why can't you sign this?
Yeah.
Your opportunity was when you was in your meeting.
I think it would be better if it was spelled out in the order conditions. I was talking to Chuck before that, you know, we're running into a lot of things that were written before with different members of the commission, and this, you know, 2,700 square feet was like, written ambiguously. There's things that are written kind of
without knowing exactly where
what,
it is.
What they were talking
the
about. So I think
like
the clearer these as these projects get developed, and in this one in particular, you know, because those houses are going to be, you know, brought in separately. We're going to have different, you know, applications for the ones within our jurisdiction. So.
Is that Lowell Street?
No, that's a different project.
No, different project.
Oh, sorry.
That's Main Street.
Main Street. Oops.
They will be built.
Yeah, but I guess the point is these have to be. We have to take some care in putting these together and making sure that the applicant and, you know, the applicant's representative can understand these. So.
And I think Strawberry Hill Lane is a perfect example of that. I mean, we're looking at hindsight now saying.
Exactly.
Especially because a significant amount of work that they're proposing for mitigation is exactly within the resource area.
When I was talking to Anika, and Anika and I think can meet up here tomorrow at 11. Are you available around that time?
Yeah.
Dave, you want to join us? Or?
Sure, for what? Oh, no, sorry. An appointment tomorrow.
All right.
I can't go.
We're going through the order of conditions.
As long as we don't have a quorum, we're good.
All right, you can't come.
I guess I'll let you guys handle it then.
All right.
I mean, everyone's free to give their input to Chuck as they review. It's not an exclusive review process.
I guess it is something you guys feel like, and that's fine. You want to sit down and put more thought into, not something that we want to just go through. I mean, we're waiting for them. We are essentially waiting for them right now. We want to go through it.
Do we want to go through it?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
No. I've looked at it. No.
Okay.
If I send this back to you, and I said, because mine come up on my computer, it's 32 pages. Same thing on yours?
No.
It starts at page 13. I think it was only 29 pages.
It starts on page 13.
Because
you attach
the wetland,
to the back of
wetland has.
Oh, yeah, I got 14.
What I'll do is I'll highlight the things that I highlight the things that I have in a different color and send it back, save it and send it back to you with questions, comments.
And anybody else is welcome. But we only have until next Wednesday to sign.
To sign. Because it's
21 days, yes. 21 days is up next Wednesday.
Does that mean a special additional meeting?
No.
We have to have four people show up to town hall and sign?
Don't we have to have the vote to approve the order of conditions?
Yes.
Yeah.
So we do. So we
I'm going to be in
I won't be here.
Becky's not going to be here.
I'm not going to be here.
All next week?
All next week.
I'm going to be last.
There's still
tomorrow.
Four.
Yeah.
There's still four. Al, Dave, Mike, Harry. No?
Not next Wednesday.
But if we're having... If we're having a meeting, we have to get it posted. We have to, right?
Right.
So the earliest you could have a meeting would be Monday night from now.
What's the, is it Tuesday nights that town hall's open late?
It's every night.
It's every night.
Could we ask, is it legal to ask for an extension from the applicant?
We close the hearing. I don't think you can unclose it. I mean, you really just have to get this done. You can either do it tonight, or you can come back on Monday and do it, or Tuesday and do this. You're not going to be here next week, but that doesn't seem to be a problem. You don't have to sign it. We have enough people
right,
to sign
right.
it. It's just that if you want to put some input into it, then.
So we'll work that out tomorrow.
Right.
Make a motion to approve all the changes that you are going to make.
Well, I'm sure those changes will get finalized into something.
Then we'll have a meeting. We can even have a meeting in the afternoon. Is anyone around in the afternoon that can pop in or during
tomorrow,
the day?
Yeah.
What? Not tomorrow. I can't do a meeting tomorrow.
Monday or Tuesday.
I might be able to do it
Tuesday.
Thursday.
Is it tomorrow, Thursday?
It expires by then.
Tomorrow's Thursday.
How about Tuesday?
No, next Thursday.
It expires by next Thursday.
Oh, tomorrow's Thursday. No, you can't do it tomorrow.
It has to be signed on Wednesday.
Wednesday.
So, no, I was totally mistaken. Don't forget about what I just said.
Okay.
So we can do a meeting on Monday night or Tuesday night.
And I'm available.
I can't do Monday.
We're all here in an open meeting.
Really.
Why don't we just do it?
Yeah. I mean...
Without changes to this.
No, make the changes.
The changes are big. The changes are big that they're talking about. It's not one sentence here and there.
Like what?
Let me read you a sentence. At least 21 days prior to the removal of roadway siltation area and the street outfall velocity reduction retrofitting and the start of any work on the site submit. You want to read it?
There you go.
There are some run-on sentences.
Okay. So run-on sentences are something we can complete tonight. If we're talking about changing content, then that's big. I mean, it's going to be difficult. It sounds like it's going to be difficult to get this four people in a quorum again next week.
Why is that?
I think we could have been done if we started doing it 10 minutes ago.
No, it's more. You got to get your head around it. What the changes that you guys want to make, what I'm hearing is, they really want to get the whole thought process together so there's no ambiguity in the order of conditions. So you need to read it through, make the changes, read it through again, and make sure everything flows together. So that's what it is.
Do that already?
I agree. I mean, this was a little different. I mean, Anika helped me with it. I think that there's a lot of repeated parts.
It's okay. I guess the repetition's okay, but there are some things in this that are difficult to understand, and like I said, if you're signing this or recording this at a registry of deeds, and somebody goes back and
Al, you're mostly around, right?
Yeah.
And Dave, you're mostly around.
Yep.
Mike, I can drive it to you. Oh, unless
you're in
New York.
We have to vote. We need to have a vote next week. So the problem is not me coming in to sign it.
Phone as well, can't we? I know selectmen have done that at their meetings.
Oh, you
people
mean patching people in?
Yeah,
they've called people in and had
mm-hmm.
votes over the
phone. We can check on that.
I know they've done that.
But we should probably try for what we know about also. So if we absolutely can't get people here, then than the phone.
This isn't the first order of conditions. Let's just see what the hell's wrong with it and bang it out and get this done.
Do you have any comments on it?
No, I thought it was fine.
Okay.
I thought Chuck did a fine job. But if, I mean, I don't mind adding comments if you have them, but why don't we just do it now? I don't think we all have to like read it like a novel and then read it again after we make changes.
Good evening. We've been waiting for you.
We're just about to leave.
Oh, you're there 4 minutes early.
Now it's too late. Now we're going to be here till
11. No one out in the hallway, so there's nobody in there.
So,
did you read this?
I did.
No. Any questions?
I have a couple of comments and clarifications.
Oh, good. Let's go.
Right on my phone.
Overall, I didn't have a tremendous heartburn over the order of conditions. Item number 8, page 17. I'm just curious that this, the TSS removal chart was in the drainage calculations. And I'm just curious if it documents it's more than 80% TSS removal, so why is that an issue now?
Not an issue. Well, it's an issue because the engineer has made it an issue. So I guess, just like we said at the last meeting, he needs the answers to his memo, and this was one of them. So we're just waiting for that. So if you're asking, does it qualify or not, we defer to the engineer, and he hasn't gotten any feedback. And you know why? Because that's in,
right,
you know, recovering. So it's just, that's just one of those things.
All right. Item number 9 is the first mention of an independent environmental monitor. I'm assuming that's somebody like me.
No, this is an independent monitor. And it goes on further.
In
the conditions, special
several times.
Yes, the special conditions. Let's see where. Number 5 in special conditions, it mentions it, but it doesn't say.
Conservation officer report with photos of all the work in the Waverly siltation area.
Right, it's mentioned several times in there, the environmental monitor. At one point it says a person with 7 years experience in habitat evaluation and wetland replication design.
Where are you with that, Bill?
That is page 18, condition number 13. And I don't suppose there's a lot I can do to persuade you otherwise, but I'm going to be fully involved in this project. And the requirement of an environmental monitor that's going to be there weekly is just like an exorbitant expense. And these environmental monitors, they tend to make this a paycheck. And I don't know if someone needs to be there weekly. Maybe they need to be there at critical times, say when the mitigation work is ongoing, but why do they need to be there weekly and walk over the site? I guess, moreover, I'd say this is somebody that's brand new. They have not been a part of the deliberations over the course of really not just this year, but the previous project. They don't know the ins and outs of it, and it would be a complete learning curve. I'm not sure why I couldn't fulfill that role. Because there's going to be weekly reporting anyway.
There, I see the sentence in that number 13. Why would we have a weekly report if no work were being done?
Most of the site is in the 100-foot buffer zone. So
work within the buffer zone, work within the...
Well, perhaps we can condition that weekly to say weekly for all work performed, all project activities performed within the buffer zone.
Well, other projects that I've worked on, familiar with in other towns, they may have a provision for a weekly erosion control monitoring to walk the site and make sure the erosion controls are functioning, still intact.
More than a provision, though, right? That's required.
It's a requirement.
Yeah.
But the way the environmental monitor is inserted so heavily into this order of conditions, that monitor is going to be there on a weekly basis. I'm not sure doing what, but it's going to be there on a weekly basis. It's a tremendous cost, and you know, somebody like I'm fully qualified to do that task. It's going to be reporting to the commission and Chuck. Chuck will decide, you know, he'll read my reports and decide whether things are in compliance or whether they're not.
Where have we used an independent?
The last site we used someone who wasn't independent was over at Eric's greenhouse, and it kind of fell apart at the end.
The wetland replication
and I think
in that situation was higher than it needs.
What is this artist?
Artist,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it ended up being, you know, a lot of things were missed, and we're waiting for a certificate of compliance. We're waiting for some simple things to be done, and I think they just wanted to move on, and they had deep enough pockets to not worry about, you know, their bond at this point. But some days they will, and we're going to, you know, get back to that in the spring. But you know, I saw the independent environmental monitor. I mean, I don't know who would have been chosen, but I also saw it as someone that would actually look through the document and make sure that we got the plans we asked for, and you know, the reports, of course, but the plans and the scheduling. I mean, maybe when that scheduling comes in and we understand when things are happening, the environmental monitor can be, you know, on site only as needed. I mean, this is just a year project, right? So I think the phasing for the, you know, the mitigation work and whatever work you're doing in the stream, if you had a number on how many days that would be, that's probably what we want the monitor for.
The mitigation.
If you're going to go independent, I would say that's the best bang for the buck. Is, you know, work with, because I'm going to be there too. So we're going to have a lot of people standing around pointing fingers. But that would be the time if you wanted an independent monitor. But you know, I would just.
The other reason for the independent monitor is that, you know, there's not a lot of you know, with the plan. And I know you're going to say no, but this is what we were talking about the whole time. Is there the plan and the application, the operation and maintenance plan, is not very exact, and we're not getting down to where you're digging out, where, you know, exactly where the mixture you're putting in and things like that. And I can't be there all the time, and I think that, you know, we could become comfortable with the situation and move forward if we had someone there for the work that's being done in the buffer zone. And that's, when it was brought up, that's why I thought it would be a good idea, because if I'm not there and this is a one-year project, you're doing four houses, you're going to be moving at lightning speed, and things can be done, and we all know that I'm not going to be able to tell anybody to take that out and let's redo it.
I would disagree, because you have that power of the enforcement order.
So
done correctly, you have that power. And if you're alluding to some other project where things got away and the contractor or the applicant is shirking on the responsibilities, that's an enforcement order. So,
well, in that particular case, we have a bond.
But if they're supposed to be doing reporting, or they're supposed to have a replication area in, I don't know what the circumstances were, but if that wasn't done, and it's in the plans and the order of conditions, that's a violation.
I think part of Chuck's point is that, yes, we do have, of course, enforcement order authority, and we have done that in the past because the situation has called for it. We don't want to have to get to that point where it's after the fact, and now we're issuing and chasing an enforcement order. You know, we'd rather have things done right the first time, and the plan followed in real time. Do you know what I mean? So and our guarantee and our this is an elaborate plan. You've done a wonderful job with mitigation. You know, I'm really excited with the thought that there's going to be additional wetlands. But it's a technical project, and especially for work, in my opinion, especially for work done within the 35-foot buffer or the resource area, I would like to see a regular person present when activities, you know, an independent monitor for the activities that are dealing directly that day with those areas.
We're in a 35-foot zone, and most of that's going to get done at probably a week's worth of time.
That's not capturing too much.
It's not capturing most of the road in the cul-de-sac. And maybe we could put something in the order of conditions that says once the road, I'm just going to throw this out there, once erosion control is established and once the drainage and road is set up. I mean, tell me something about the construction order. Like, at what point do we say, you know, do you want to stage it where weekly monitoring is required for certain activities but not required for other portions of the project work? And if so, we need that construction sequence detailed.
Well,
so,
that's
the
requirement.
You know what I mean?
Can I ask that a different way? Because I agree with you. I think the retention basin, is that going to be done at the beginning of the project or the end of the project?
Beginning.
So, road, so you put in the underground utilities, put in the base coat, put in the retention basin, clear up, do the wetland replication, all that stuff sort of in the excavation phase at the beginning?
As, in terms of, correct me if I'm wrong, you're going to roughen the utilities, you're roughen the road, you're probably going to form up the basin at that time because you're going to drop it in the utilities. It has to outlet to somewhere. Put a binder coat on the road. At that same time, you're probably clearing and grubbing the lots. In terms of the wetland replication, as we talked in the DRT meeting a couple months ago now, you want to do that in the dry. So that may end up not happening until July because we don't want to be fighting water table. So,
because the reason I ask is trying to think of a way to say, to your point, we need a monitor for those activities that are high impact. I don't feel like you need a monitor for a base coat of asphalt.
No, I agree. That's what I was talking about before. You know, things like the sediment in the stream, the wetland replication. You know, everything that had to do with the mitigation, if it had to be a compromise, I think.
Your retention basin, when is that going in? Is that going in when you're putting in the roadway as well?
Generally goes in prior to the actual hot topping of the road.
And that will be within the buffer zone, right?
Yes.
How long would that take, roughly?
A couple days.
So why wouldn't we have a monitor looking at that as well? I mean,
it's fine. It's more of an engineering thing than a monitor thing, but
you're within our jurisdiction.
Yeah.
So, first thing you put in is soil erosion sediment control all along. Would we be looking for that monitor?
If you're asking me, I would say any work on lot one, any work on lot two, any work. They should be there when they're clearing to make sure that no trees are cleared beyond, you know, whatever. Because things happen. These projects aren't happening one thing at a time. There's a massive amount of work going on at the same time. People can just park some truck, you know, over there, and over there happens to be in the wetland. I know Bill's going to be there watching it, but, you know, what we want to do is we want to make sure that someone's only watching it, and they're watching it for us. And Bill's, you know, Bill's been working with this company, and, you know, I agree that some things aren't going to be a problem, but I think the independent, you know, I didn't bring it up, but I don't understand why all of a sudden it was brought up, and now it's not really something that we feel strongly about.
And let me just point out too, like, with the qualifications that you've outlined here, 7 years experience in wildlife habitat and wetland replication design. So you're not talking about a staff-level person. You're looking for a mid-level person with a billing rate of probably $100 an hour. And are you expecting them to camp out on the site for 8 hours a day? And so you're talking, you know.
Well, let's look at that road.
$4,000 a week for an environmental monitor.
Look, however somebody is scheduled to be out on the site, it could be a really smart schedule that puts that high-level person out there at targeted times when key activities are going to be done. So that can be scheduled out at the project management level. And really, the billing rates and all that, that's not what we're here to decide. And that's really not in our concern view. And I appreciate that you brought it up, but we're not here to make project more painfully expensive for you, believe it or not. We're just here to make sure that the Wetlands Protection Act is followed appropriately to the correct standards. And, you know, that road especially, for that road to even be put in, about a quarter of that cul-de-sac is going to have a retaining wall right off the Jersey, the barrier, the curving of the road. And so there's even a question I have now about the sequencing of that, because if that's a 4-foot wall, right now it would be a 4-foot wall through fill. And then what, the fill gets removed and regraded after? I mean, you know what I mean? It's a complicated project within the resource area and within, and especially, in my opinion, within the 35 feet. And it's not something that's really straightforward without an expert. And I believe you're qualified, and I have no doubts you would do an adequate job out there, more than adequate job out there. I'm just saying there's enough going on, especially within the 35 foot, to warrant more eyes during the process.
Let me ask
quality
Chuck
assurance.
A question.
Working for the builder, that's quality control. You're making sure he's following what's going on. The idea of the monitor is quality assurance, which is usually done by a separate party. I would just agree, though, that I think we need to your point about experience, I think call to attention, you know, I don't know that that's necessarily who we're looking for out in the field. I think there's, you know, the option of having someone doing the work under that guidance. I mean, that's how somebody gets 7 years experience, is being out on sites like this. And
Chuck, let me ask you a question. You've had experience in other communities. What do you think is a reasonable, amount of time for an environmental monitor? I don't necessarily, one of the things that happens during construction is, you know, we could say, oh, it's scheduled for this day, but all of a sudden something happens, you know, and people just stand around and nothing gets done. You know, that is a waste of time and money. On some of your projects?
I don't know how you tease that out. I would say if you could do all the work or have groups of work that needs to be monitored, done in on certain weeks, you could bring them in for that amount of time. But, you know, outside of that, once a week to check out erosion control, I mean, I'm not sure. Do you want that? It should be where the applicant proposes several people, and we look at their qualifications. I mean, that's what I would, or we could propose also. How long? I don't know. I mean, we've had some projects up in Boxford where someone was there all the time, and I know someone else who's doing a project who is there all the time, but he's also running his own business, so when he's absolutely not needed, he goes and does his own thing. But his base is right there, so he's kind of like working out of his car, and he's not charging the applicant for 8 hours a day because he's really not needed there 8 hours a day, so when he gets the feel of what's going on, he can do his other work.
This site is only, a couple acres? It's only a couple of acres. Honestly, if someone said, I need you to monitor this site, I'd be thinking maybe a half a day on a Friday. On a weekly basis, you go there. There's just not a lot that happens that quickly that you need somebody there full time. But granted, the mitigation stuff, you're probably going to want, even when I do wetland replications and oversee them, I don't watch the people dig every scoop. We show up in the morning, this is what I'd like you to get accomplished. I might show up at lunchtime, I might show up at the end of the day, the first couple of days, but I won't stand there watching because it's not necessary.
Well, I don't want to get accused of being on the applicant side again, but I have been in the position of several of these subdivisions, and I absolutely know that a full-time monitor is a complete waste of time. So if we could come to some sort of compromise, a few hours a week I think would be appropriate. Someone to show up that we trust to write a report that they've been there 4 or 5 hours once a week, they've been in contact with Bill in coordination with the developer, and they've figured out what hours during that week they should go there, the peak times when the most important work is being done, have them report to us weekly, but limit that to a certain amount of hours a week, whatever it's 8 or 4 or 6 or whatever it is, but to give somebody, you know, like those 8 hours a day, 5 days a week.
So let me try to put that into practice. What if we said, just hypothesis, once a week we'll get a report from the monitor that says that the erosion control is in place and effective, and the monitor is going to be there at any time any work's being done within the 35-foot infrastructure zone. So that's putting up the wall, installing the retention basin, not necessarily being there, but inspecting at the end of the day, maybe.
How about there at the kickoff of, you know, you do end of the day is when potentially mistakes are discovered. You know, I think it's more valuable time, use of time for an expert to be there at the beginning when the work is starting to say, here's how we're going to do this. The standards are this for this project. You've got clear limits defined. Let's take that first scoop of fill and let's get down. Do we know what depth everyone's, you know what I mean? As opposed to, you know, end of the day, come back and see something.
I have no preference on that. Any time during the day is fine. But I think trying to Al's point, align the monitoring work with where the risk is and not overdo
how would you measurably write that into an order of conditions?
Well, that's what I was saying.
What are the activities?
Inspecting.
Take a stab at it.
Yeah.
A weekly erosion control inspection and be present when mitigation work is ongoing. Or erosion control and compliance inspection. It's a 2-acre site. You can walk the erosion controls in about 20 minutes. And you can, if there's anything that's beyond the limit of work, you'll know right away. It's not all that complicated. But the person doesn't have to be there the entire time.
I agree.
And the other thing is, I think that I'd be hesitant in getting caught up in the weekly, because there's going to be weeks when you don't need that person on the site.
Usually what happens is you get someone there, and then they're going through this. And I don't agree with just erosion control. I want this guy out there to make sure that what's taken out is being taken down to the proper level, because we didn't get that in the report. And what the hell is actually going on at the outfall when they have that velocity reducing thing? I mean, what's the deal with that? So we need someone standing there.
So that's the
mitigation
work.
When that happens. So
that's not mitigation work. That's
not mitigation.
It's stormwater management.
So can we define the work that we want them there on site?
I would say, you guys can take it after here, that you would have your monitor read their order of conditions, and they would decide when they need to be there and how to sequence it in such a way. Well, you know, I know, Bill, you always talk about money. I mean, you got four houses going here. Let's say that's $4 million. We shouldn't be talking about money.
But I don't disagree with them, though.
We don't need to mention.
It doesn't matter. It's $20 million.
You know, when it comes right down to it, you're qualified enough to hire or to propose somebody who is a qualified professional. And, you know, you want to hire somebody who's going to do a really good job at the best price, right? Right, and you're going to be smart about that. I trust that that's going to happen. Because otherwise, you know, we've got enforcement orders that are going to get issued, and we're going to have the authority to stop work and delay and hold up the schedule. I think there's enough. What I would really appreciate, because this is where I don't know the detail, is a construction sequence, especially pertaining to the work within, I'm going to say, 50 feet of the existing wetland. A construction sequence highlighting the work within 50 feet of the wetland. And let's take a look at that and see how often an environmental monitor needs to be there, especially for those activities. And let's talk about that.
Okay.
We do work within 50 feet all the time without a monitor.
What did you say?
Don't we do work. We allow work within 50 feet routinely without an environmental monitor.
Right.
Correct. Do you know the difference, though, between those projects and this one?
What?
Probably not a
the
lot
difference
of
is a lot of these activities are literally creating new wetlands and restoring other parts of other wetlands. So this is in the resource area.
Which is a
area,
good thing, which is why we approve the plan. So let the guy do the work.
Right, but that's what we're trying to get to.
But if it's not done right,
you're right.
It never
if it's not
gets
done
fixed.
Right, this board, listen, we can have a monitor, but if it's not done right, this board has the authority to make sure it's done right. We already have measures within our means to make it right if it's not right.
But we want
it right done the first time. I get that. And they do too. But if for some reason they don't, it's within our authority to say, take it apart and do it again until it's right.
It's in their authority, but does the commission have the mettle to do that? And
of course it does.
My experience on other commissions, when push comes to shove, they look for another compromise. So we don't get exactly what we want, and then it's compromised down to a marginal situation. And this is a way to make sure that the one thing that allowed this project to get so close and be to build out so much gets done correctly, and now we're cutting it down. So I think the monitor's important.
We have a great plan that we've reviewed and accepted.
Well,
we're not cutting anything
I don't
down.
Think anyone here except you thinks that that plan is adequate for what the work they're doing. It doesn't mention a lot. It's a bunch of great pictures, and they're in color, but it's not a really detailed plan.
We've already reviewed and approved it.
That doesn't mean it was great. The applicant told us that they are finished and that we need to write everything we want into the order. That's simply what happened.
That's fine. Let's write everything we want into the order.
So
I don't know if
everything we want
is a 40-hour-a-week monitor.
So we wrote everything we wanted into the order because we didn't want to get to the site and for the applicant to say we're finished and now you have to enforce it if you want to do more. So if we have an environmental monitor, then things are going to be done correctly from the start. Independent environmental monitor. And I think we're only fighting about when this person should be there. And I get that. You know, maybe the whole time doesn't make any sense, but certainly for a lot of the work along that water course and when they're doing any of the work near the building number, lot number 2 and lot number 1, they're taking out a septic system, they're working over by the outfall on Lowell Street, they're going to be cleaning up the 2 culverts down by the MBTA tracks. There's some, you know, logs or whatnot. All that's supposed to be cleaned out and the obstructions are supposed to be stopped. I'm not going to be there 100% of the time. So if this monitor is there, we're going to get that done. I mean, again, you know, what happens on some projects? You say it at the meeting and then the guy goes past that point of the project, so he's going to have to, like, go over a freshly put in lawn to get to the back to pull out some trash that's in the wetlands. And he just cries and says, hey, look, I can't do this. And the commission says, all right, we'll just do our best. We'll work with this. That happens all the time. I just want to make sure it doesn't happen this time.
So, well, and I think the other thing we just learned in one of the other projects we're looking at is, don't shoot me if I'm wrong on this, but you guys could sell the plan tomorrow, the land and the plan. We're dealing with somebody new. That's what the last people said. So,
I mean, in 3 years, I want to build a beautiful project here. I want to do the wetlands perfect. It's our first time in Reading. There's no shortcuts here.
It's not a question of shortcuts. I watched that giant crater at Downtown Crossing sit vacant for years and years and years. And stuff happens. It's beyond your control. So, you know.
Great building today, though.
It's great. It's great.
Well, we've had offers even in the process, and we're going to see this through.
It's
just what we do. We've never sold the property, and we don't
think
about
that. You know, so let's.
Can we just get down to basics? And so, what's the first thing you do? You clear to get the roadway in, right?
Erosion controls, clear and drop.
Erosion controls. Don't you have to clear something to get the erosion controls in? Because you got the roots there?
Well, we would like to clear, not grub.
Okay.
And then clear, erosion
yeah,
controls,
yeah.
Then grub.
Okay.
And then roughen the utilities.
Okay, let's go back to the erosion control. What if we had an environmental monitor, you know, for some time during that? How long do you think that would take?
You don't need to have someone during there. You just need to see the end product. Is it installed correctly? You don't need to watch someone trench in silt fence. You can go along at the end and tug on it. If it's not
okay.
Trenched in
so,
properly.
So at the end of that process,
yep.
We'd have an environmental monitor, like what, 4 hours?
Inspect the erosion
inspection.
Control.
Yeah,
inspection of erosion controls after installation.
So Chuck, you're rolling your eyes. I mean,
it's incredibly hard to go through the whole project like this.
No, because I'm thinking that when you're doing the work in the wetland, you need somebody there most of a lot of the time.
I think they could put the erosion control in and, you know, I don't even know. How would you take down,
so
you'd mark all the trees and then take them down?
Surveyors would mark the limit of clearing.
Yeah, so okay. then they could check that.
Right.
You know, hopefully nothing would be cut on the other side. That's that's pretty clear, that that would be just one site visit.
Right. I mean...
Can I ask you a quick question about the erosion control? So in one, in the western part of the site, it's at the 35-foot. So is there going to be a change in erosion control when you get to the fill removal near the end, that part of the cul-de-sac?
No. It's already
so the erosion control
straw bales and silt fence.
So that, so is that line, so is that line of hay bales and silt fence going to go out to the wetland line, existing wetland line, for that fill removal area?
It goes out to the existing wetland line, yes, and then you pull the fill
from,
out, and then you install, once that's done and your plantings are in, you install a new line at the upland edge of it.
Okay, so at some point, it's the erosion control is going to leave the 35-foot and angle down to the wetland line itself.
Right.
And go
the
along
EC line
the
is marked on
area.
The plan.
Well, that's actually what I'm looking at right now. It says erosion.
No, the SWIP plan.
No, Anika, this meeting's closed.
I mean, right, I know. I'm just asking for a clarification on the existing plan. So, but that's part of what I'm wondering is, you know, for part of this, does the erosion control fence get moved? Is that part of the sequence,
no.
Is my question.
No. The original EC line will stay until the commission allows it to be removed. We may add additional EC, we will add additional EC at the top of the new wetland replication area, but everything else that's put in initially stays until the commission says it can be removed.
Okay.
So can I ask a question? What do you think your realistic start date would be? What are you targeting right now?
Still have to get through planning board. June 1.
So doing the replication area after your starting date isn't going to be an issue. You're going to be in midsummer. So Chuck, maybe, I don't know if this is a viable option, how about a full-time monitor for the first 6 weeks of the project? Can you complete 90% of that detention pond and roadway and do all the cleaning and all the other work you have to do in 4 to 6 weeks? So we don't have some guy in an open end all the time, and then after that I think we could write in that we would trust Bill to give us weekly updates on the project.
Bill,
I want it for certain activities.
Yeah, Bill, when you're removing.
Well, there's a monitor
the
there.
Fill.
40 hours a week for 6 weeks. Well,
they did
those
the construction sequencing
yeah,
plan. Then we could sit down and understand where we wanted the monitor in that spot. I mean, you could do that. I mean,
he's gonna get all the work done in 4 to 6 weeks that we want to see everything in the 35. He's gonna clean out this. He's gonna clean it out. He's gonna do the head wall. He's gonna do the out wall. He's gonna replicate. You can do all that work in 6 weeks. All that important stuff.
Someone
wanted to
for that.
I'd rather communicate with Chuck, say at the beginning of or at the end of each week, and say, here's what's anticipated for the next week, because weather might delay
right.
us, supplies, whatever. We just don't know. So I'd rather if.
So there lies the problem.
I love the idea of a full time monitor because I agree. They sit there and there's nothing to watch.
Yeah, but if we
watch.
Shrink that down to.
But, so it's better to have
but we're not
Bill,
requiring
Bill,
a full-time
so
monitor.
This is what part of the problem is. Is
we're not. He's proposing it as if we are doing that, but we're not. We're just because we want an environmental monitor for any work within the 50 feet of the wetland.
In a daily, is it
in a weekly report?
Okay. So.
What's that?
So what is that during that week?
I don't know. It's not.
Well,
I don't. We don't have a weekly schedule.
That's
so,
what we're trying
so
to tighten up.
But
right.
The sentence in the order of conditions says the monitor is responsible for ensuring that work is performed in compliance with this order, and shall be present at the site during any activities requiring reporting to the conservation.
And I think
in
those things
order,
need to be
so,
kept in there.
I mean, that doesn't say full time.
Work during in-stream remediation, or however you want to word that, and a once-a-week erosion and compliance report.
I think
they're literally
going to
walk the site in 20 minutes.
Is that? I mean, it sounds like that's what Chuck is saying. He's going to have
then let's write it in there.
Yeah. I think it's vague right now. I don't think it's clear what we want them out there for.
It's not. I think you're only looking at one sentence. In the conditions, it's in there several times of what he's supposed to do and when he's supposed to be there. So
he or she.
He or she.
Right.
Yeah. So it mentions a monitor. It says, this is the qualifications. And then it says a couple of for instances where it needs to, they need to be there to monitor, and we need to get reports back.
So is another
but
way
it, but I can do the erosion control. We don't need a monitor to do the erosion control. I want a monitor to make sure that everything that we've asked for happens, and that includes plans. So, you know, and I don't care about the plans after the project, but before the project, you know, to be on top of this. There's a lot of other things going on in town hall, so to say that we don't want to monitor, this is one of the sites. Another site that we had an environmental monitor on is when we had the redundant water line between Ivy and Belmont, and that worked out great. So it was a good site, ended up working out correctly, there was no issues, Kurt Young, his people, we had someone out there for that. And I ran into the guy one time.
How often was that person out there?
I don't know, but when he was there when they crossed the stream, and he was there when they were taking down the trees, and they gave weekly reports, and, you know, it worked out really well.
Yeah, is it possible for you to make, you know, bulleted items or benchmarks as to what, you know, like in here where it tells about the Lowell Street culvert and the MBTA railroad track culvert, if you can make a list that is possible that you would want someone to be there perhaps beginning of the day and end of day for each one of those critical points in this project? Because like Bill said, that, you know, you get four straight days of rain.
Not gonna have any work.
They're not gonna be there. So it's
so what why do we think the monitor is gonna be there? They're not hiring them full time.
Well, if you say in order conditions and stipulated they're gonna be there actually.
They need to be
weeks.
There once that week.
Right. So
well but you go you definitely check erosion control when it's raining.
Right.
So that doesn't seem to make a difference.
Right.
You know, Bill is going to be in contact with the monitor too, and the monitor, I would almost suspect the monitor to be in contact more with Bill, asking him what's coming up next week. I want to plan my week. When are you going to be? Are you on your schedule? When are you going to start this? When are you going to start that? All those things are tough for me to do and deal with everything else in town. So
and you shouldn't have to, I mean, that's too much on you for a project this size.
You comfortable?
And I think when we're outside of this area of where we're super concerned about and everyone feels comfortable about it, you could be petitioned by the applicant to reduce the monitoring to every 2 weeks erosion control, or maybe Bill would take it over at that time. And I don't know if you're doing the work that I'm worried about at the beginning, the end, or whatever, so it doesn't make any sense to say for the first 6 weeks, but if it was the 6 weeks that we're doing the work, that would make sense. Or
no,
it might be 4 weeks worth
that's
of work.
That's what needs to be clarified, because there's no point in having someone watching you build a road 50 feet away from the wetlands.
Well, that's not what we're asking for. We're asking for a monitor for any work that's within 100 feet. That will take care of what you 50 feet. That's will take care of what you just said.
So does this come
make sense
circle?
To have Bill manage the times that the monitor is going to be on site?
No.
It's up to them to decide.
Yeah. The monitor will read the order of conditions and confer with Bill about when
in situations where
I mean by to read the order of conditions, and then he knows the schedule as to when things are going to happen, and then they'll say, look, we're going to be doing X, Y, and Z on Tuesday. We're going to need you here on Tuesday at 8 o'clock.
Yeah. I mean, I've not bought into the fact that there's a guy out there that doesn't have enough work, so he's going to make a life out of this job. So
there are companies out there that will hire a person.
We're going to make sure we
to be on the payroll.
Wouldn't Bill have a say in who get tired. I mean, the applicant, I mean, they can say yay or nay. I mean, there can be a list of...
I think it's going to be a lot better than it's being described. I mean, it seems to me that you could find someone who had another thing going on and didn't need to be there, and it would be a lot of communication about what's going to happen tomorrow, when do I need to be there, and, you know, it adds work to Bill, because I'm not going to be updated at the end of the week and find out what has happened. It's going to be more or less what is going to happen in the next couple of days, so the monitor can be there. I think it's really encouraged that we have that happen.
Bill, it sounds like what you're trying to do is just make sure that a monitor doesn't turn into a big waste of money.
That's primarily it, but it's so vague. If you're going to have an environmental monitor requirement, it's so vague in this. I mean, there's nothing about payment. There's nothing about money in escrow. There's a whole other category of stuff that goes along with the environmental monitor that we didn't even get to yet. But typically, if I have an order of conditions, like over in Woburn, Mr. Jameson's doing a project, they're required to do weekly inspections. It specifies weekly inspections. You had in there about a measurement of rainfall that triggers an erosion inspection. But I do weekly inspections and do an email report to the commission. And it's a one lot site, but this is only three additional lots. Like I said, you can walk from one end to the other and back in 15 minutes. So it's not a huge effort. But you can also specify when remediation work is going on within the stream. You can specify the outlet control starting at Lowell Street, the outlet control, removal of the sediment, removal of the trash, construction of the wetland replication area and historic fill, the unclogging of the culvert down by the MBTA tracks, both of them, and removal of the landscape debris along Plymouth Street. I mean, that's the time when you want the environmental monitor.
Why doesn't that, so, and I'm just not sure why it doesn't work to say any work within 50 feet of the buffer.
Because there's lots of work, the road's within 50 feet. So, you know, if they're going up and down the street, I mean, is that work, or, you know, what's your definition of work, activity? You don't want to put the monitor.
Since the environmental monitor needs to be there for that. For that work. For the road, it certainly could be modified that they're not there every second of the day. But as we get closer than the road,
I'm
it
just
seems
throwing
to me
out,
that you
I
would.
Saw some heads nodding in agreement that the remediation part plus a weekly inspection, say the remediation's done, then you still get a weekly inspection. At some point, it's not going to make sense, you know. The site has been rough graded, the work that's all carpentry work. At some point, it doesn't make sense to do weekly inspections. I would hire the monitor with petition that we reduce that schedule. But I think a good place to start would be when remediation work is ongoing and at least once a week to do the erosion controls.
Say it again, but
that's my suggestion.
You know where I'm at. Those, you know, outside of the 50 foot, I think we have the LIDs. You know, we want to make sure that those are not just scooped out. They have to have the right soil in them. We want to check for clay. We want to check for rocks, you know, bedrock or something like that. Someone needs to be on site when that happens. I mean, there's a lot of Marxist. I don't think that me and Bill are so far off about what we're saying. I just think that when he says just for remediation work, to me, I would rather say something like any work within 35 feet, 40 feet, you know, outside of the, maybe the road's not included, but the retaining wall would certainly be included, you know.
Where I come down on this is, we don't want to make this an onerous process, but at the same time, I think we have to maintain the flexibility of the commission to decide when we I'd like you to go keep an eye on those. That's the sort of thing we want to have done, right? Whereas your intention is not to have them stand there and wait for someone to decide to dig a hole.
I think
so,
between Bill and me and the monitor, I'm sure.
That's working out.
I know. I'm always hearing that it's just going to stand there the whole time. I haven't seen that too much. But I, you know, I'm not in. I haven't seen.
I think how the order of conditions is written is fine, and how the applicant desires to most efficiently and effectively schedule and implement that order is, I think that can still fit what you're talking about, Bill. I don't see anywhere in this order where the order doesn't agree with what you're saying.
Can I ask just some questions about
the
independent monitor? Who hires the independent monitor?
Yeah.
Who
pays?
Pays. They hire them too. They select them. The contract between the applicant and the independent monitor.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
Who decides if they're doing a poor job? Does the commission have the right to fire that independent monitor if they're doing a?
Typically,
the
contract is with the town and the environmental monitor.
They're not independent.
We're talking about peer review.
Yeah, that's
we're talking about scope of services, peer review, contract.
No, I know it's.
No,
that's what we're talking about.
That.
That's why it's over the top.
It doesn't seem like they're independent. We're just asking for someone other than Bill. I mean, that's all we're really asking for. That we're asking for a qualified person other than Bill. The fact of the matter is, they're hired by the applicant. They're fired by the applicant. They're controlled by the applicant's the one deciding when they show up to the site. I mean, they're not independent.
They're supposed to act independent based on their professional ethics.
Right.
And that's what we have to trust, is that a qualified professional
is
going to act on the order of conditions as the order of conditions writes out. And
then you go to the job,
they've got their professional.
Think, well, this is great, but if I want to get the next job, who do I got to keep?
I haven't found that if you hire someone outside of the company, so I don't want to use any examples. Yeah, somebody else is going to take
that.
It seriously.
You were hired by somebody.
Even if they know
so
each other.
There.
So, they're supposed to read the
I
order.
I agree with Albert then. And what's the point of going out? Because I obviously want to.
You know, we've taken
this
like every which way. I mean, we need to move on here. This is just getting ridiculous now.
Do you have a proposed change to the wording in the order of conditions based on what you've commented on? Because otherwise, I think
well,
order of conditions wording meets what you're saying.
Let's just ask the question: does Bill qualify for what the order of conditions is asking for?
No, because it says independent.
So, Bill, do you want to change the order of conditions to remove the word independent?
I would suggest that. Thank you for the opportunity.
I don't know why. If we're not going to go full-blown peer review, which is not a good idea in my opinion, then Bill's qualified. He's here. He works in this town. He works in other towns. He's a professional. He's not going to, he's not going to do anything he's not supposed to do, I don't think.
You know what, if the order of conditions couldn't change owners, I could get behind that. That's not how this works.
I don't think you have a problem with that. If the order of conditions changes ownership, you'd need to hire an independent monitor.
When I read
right,
through
you
this,
wouldn't be.
That's how you take what you say.
When I read through this order conditions, every time I saw that indication, I just thought it was you.
Well,
I never thought it was
a question.
An independent. I didn't think it was someone other than you. So, and until Chuck mentioned it, he didn't even take that into consideration.
So, I'll ask again. Besides independent, the word independent, do you have any other objections to how the order of conditions is worded? specifically, you know, in any of the paragraphs that it mentions environmental monitor. I mean, if we just struck the word independent but kept the rest of the wording, are you amenable to that, or do you have objections about that?
Seems reasonable, yes.
Okay, then I don't have any objections.
Do we want to add the language if the property changes hands that the new owner would, it'd be in there, the conditions that any new owner would be under the obligation to hire an independent engineer?
Is that necessary?
Nobody is independent.
I don't know if it's necessary, because the new owner is going to read, hopefully, their order of conditions.
Receive or be told about it.
And we will tell them, look, we have conditions in the order, in this order, that we've debated at length over many meetings, and we'd like to see met.
It's in the order of conditions.
It's in the order of conditions. And so I don't think we need to add how the property, a new property owner, might treat one part.
Okay.
I think that's too speculative.
So can I just throw this out to the commission that do we all agree that we can remove the word independent from the order of conditions? Because I think that's a stumbling block, I think, that we have to get over and agree on.
I have no objection to that. Where is it written that the
number 8.
Where's the word independent in that order?
Where
page 18? Is it
13?
Back.
Oh yeah, page 18, item 13.
Okay, so it's we're talking about
the
first sentence.
The first one
sentence.
Is page 17.
17, paragraph 9.
Okay, let's
it says between Laurel Street and the Culver and MBTA railroad tracks, this work will be monitored by an independent environmental monitor. That's all lowercase, and then everywhere else, the environmental monitor is capitalized. So
there is the word independent on page 18, condition 13. But
I have no which sentence is
third sentence.
Third sentence.
Right. 1, 2. It's still a professional who's needs to submit, in this condition especially, their qualifications for review and approval before groundbreaking. So
you realize you're hiring Bill.
Right.
I am not hiring Bill.
Yeah, you are. By taking out the word independent, that job's going to Bill. How come you can't see that? That's what everyone else is talking about. That's what everyone else is talking about.
Right.
There is a review process in condition 13 that says that person's resume is going to be submitted before for this Conservation Commission's review and approval. And I'm not here to judge your qualifications for this project right now. Because that's not what this is about right now. This is about getting through this order of conditions.
So you want to take out the word independent, but Bill still is not allowed to be that person. Is that what I'm hearing?
I reserve that decision until I see a resume.
Why did you want independent in the first place?
Because it was recommended in the DEP policy documents.
Okay.
So
you're talking about
so
the DEP wetlands replication guide. I mean, that's sort of morphed. Well, that's the 2002 document, and a lot of things in there have morphed.
Well,
and it's
it is what it is. DEP hasn't changed it since 2002, so I can't speak to what it's morphed into in practice right now, because I'm not an environmental monitor myself professionally. So are there any other comments or questions?
Next item.
Is everybody in agreement with the removal of independent, which allows Bill Manuel to do the environmental monitoring?
I
yes.
Yep.
I want to make it clear that we are not writing in this order of conditions that Bill manual.
We are, but that
we
by
not.
Doing that,
when he submits his resume, he's obviously qualified.
He's not,
I'm
going to
wait until that day.
He's
okay,
not
I'm trying to deal with the order of conditions.
Either.
And I know you're all
saying, yeah, no,
let's get
in,
let's
I
Nika,
go.
Nika, he's
not
ruled
out.
Let's go.
So it looks like the steps that need to be taken is we're going to get some applicants. We're going to get some applicants to review. Is that what everyone agrees? Because I don't think
I
wasn't even following that when you said that.
I'm going to submit my resume for your approval.
So if people have objections to just one resume being submitted, you can ask for more than one resume to be submitted.
Well, we're going to provide some too if we're going to on
the
resume.
Same thing. Then how do we get involved with another applicant submitting their resume and telling this guy, you got to hire him and pay for him without peer review? How do we do that?
Did you read the order of conditions?
What does peer review have to do with this?
Well, essentially what you're saying, what you want to do is peer review. You want to hire
an environmental
monitor
under
peer review.
But is it up
to you? You want him to pay and us to hire him.
That has happened
in
the past.
I know it has, but that's a whole different ballgame. That's a scope of services, three reviews, a contract. We're two months or 3 months away from that. Yeah, that's a whole different ball of wax. You can't say, okay, we're going to write in here three names, and we're going to pick the name, and the applicant's going to pay.
That is exactly what we've done in the past.
We've never been involved with any of that other stuff. We've just asked for independent monitor to review the site. We came up with conditions, and that person reported to us. Paid for by the applicant.
That's not what we did on the most recent one where we found the small vernal pool.
Randall Road.
That was a complete peer review, right?
That's very different. That's not even what we're talking about.
It's very true, though.
That's not the same thing as this.
Independent monitor.
I'm not sure.
Oh, okay. Oh.
But she is, she's over at Austin Prep doing the work there.
Right.
So she's in the area. I mean, there would be two jobs in the same area.
All right, let's move on.
Page 18. List of special conditions number one says we have to notify the abutters of work behind Plymouth Road, and I just question why we need to notify them when work is on our site. We need to give them 21-day notice of removal of fill areas behind Plymouth Road.
I think the presumption is you will probably need their approval to access those fill areas by their property.
It's on his property?
It's on their property. Correct, but they're going to have to traverse the water to get to those fill areas because they're...
Can we just move on? You always notify them. The abutters aren't going to get notified. I mean, give me a break. That's just one letter, 55 cents. Come on. Next.
Move on. Sorry, Bill.
That's not even worth fighting about.
Page 19, number 5, we talked about the roadway siltation, the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7th sentence, the applicant must restabilize with native plants. It's a sort of a stream bed there, and we weren't planning on installing any plants. Can we insert wording or final stabilization technique as agreed with the agent? We do not specify plants there. It may just be a bare stream bed.
How do you do that? Just out of curiosity.
You take a flat shovel and you scoop it out into 5 gallon buckets and walk it out of there.
So it's just whatever's the substrate is the substrate.
It's just road sand.
So you don't see that as getting into the bank at all, that area? But if you do, do you see that sentence as, no one's asking for plants in the water course, but if you got into the bag a little bit, or you needed to because it was filled with sand, would you stabilize that area?
You don't need to.
Well, how do you know that?
Because I know where the sediment is. It's in the stream channel.
I mean, that sentence was put in there just in case they got into the bank and then they needed to stabilize that. It's, no one's talking about it.
So then can we put the bank?
Yes.
We had the applicant must restabilize, or if the work, if when the work is completed, the bank has been disturbed, then applicant must restabilize the bank with native plants. Just add that to that, that would be fine.
Page 20, condition number 13, about the retaining wall. Submit two copies of structural designs to the commission for approval. And I'm just, this seems to be unnecessary because who on this commission is qualified to review structural plans?
Mike is.
I am.
Yeah.
But you know,
it's smart.
Even so, I'm not sure it's
that. That's unusual, and I appreciate that.
No problem. A couple people before that.
Page 21, condition 16B. It talks about the wetland mitigation area, and then it. I already have a plant spec for this area, but you've changed my plant spec, and I'm just questioning why not. Use the approved plant spec.
How did we change your plant spec?
My planting spec used specific plant species. Yours says at least three tree species, three shrub species, adapted to grow in light conditions, tree seed space, irregular clusters, hummocky topography. And we talked about that during the meeting, but I already have an approved plant spec. I don't know why we're clouding that issue with something that changes it.
And we approved that plant spec, right?
Yes.
So why don't we just reference that plant spec and take out that wording? Is that okay, Chuck?
Yeah.
Just a question. Page 22, condition 19, says prior to the beginning of each phase. And I wanted everybody to be aware, as you, I'm sure you are by now, that there really isn't any phasing in this project. Just going start to finish. So basically, it's going to be at the beginning of the job. I'll let that one go.
That's irrelevant.
Page 24, and this is really bit perhaps for your benefit, page 24, condition 34, talks about environmental monitor and the administrator should be notified prior to the placement of crush cone backfill around infiltration beds. I think the design engineer, something in there ought to talk about the design engineer needs to be present as well. Page 25, condition 40, talking about that the administrator shall not sign off on any certificate of occupancy unless the commission has received all paperwork required for the certificate of compliance. That would be impossible in this project because there is a monitoring component.
Number 40, page 25.
The dwellings are going to be done and ready for occupancy probably at the end of the first year. But we need to monitor the replication areas for at least another complete growing season before we can apply for our certificate of compliance. I know, Chuck, even in the meeting you had mentioned, somebody talked, and a butter had some, said something about, do you hold this up for the CO? And you even said, we don't hold up the CO.
No, we don't. And I didn't think we wouldn't. We would probably, so in the certificate of compliance, it says that we have the right to reserve 50% of the bond to make sure that the plants, for the plantings in itself. So I'm not sure that we would even find a way to not give you your certificate of compliance. You know, we'd have the bond.
Well, we can't apply for it. We're going to be ready for COs in a year, but we can't even apply for a certificate of compliance for 2 years because that's what's in the approved documents. We need to monitor that for 2 years. So. I like the, you know, the commission designates the administrator as its administrative agent. And I assume that means for these construction sequences and the other information that you asked for along the way that I didn't specifically call out, that would be something that Chuck can approve. See some shaking heads.
That's correct. So. That's how he acts as our agent.
The part about it, in addition, if a C certificate of compliance has not been issued, the administrator shall not sign off. That's the rub right there. If a certificate of compliance has not been issued, the administrator shall, which is absolute, not sign off on any certificate of occupancy. And the sequence just can't happen that way.
So keep reading, and it says, unless we have received all paperwork required for the certificate of compliance, why can't you provide that?
It would be a year ahead of time. It would be me asking for a certificate of compliance when I don't know that the plants have survived for two growing seasons.
I think we've issued certificate of, correct me if I'm wrong, but I thought we've issued certificate of compliance without the monitoring. And we've, as Chuck just said, we've held the bond aspect of it, but issued the compliance and then,
Well, it seems to me that you only have to submit the paperwork. You have an engineer on your staff. He can monitor the site at that moment and write a letter. You can do an as-built plan because you're going to need one for your certificate of occupancy. So those two things are happening anyways. And the only other thing that we're asking for is you fill out Form 8A.
Well,
so I'm not really sure why this is a big deal. No, we won't act on it because it's not ready.
Then why am I doing it?
It's really no extra work.
And it's just useless paperwork. If I'm going to fill out an 8A and give it to you, and you're not going to act on it, but you're going to sign a CO, why am I even doing that? Because I'm going to have to come back in another year and give you all the documentation.
Somebody talk real words to me. What's 8A?
It's the
certificate of compliance form.
Two-step process. It's the first step.
All right.
Basically, name and address and some other very minor information.
But there's more to it in because the certificate of compliance requirements requires an as-built plan. The next page tells you what it all, you know, what I apply
as-built
for.
Plan is you're doing that already. We both agree on that, right? You can't get your occupancy unless you have an as-built.
Not necessarily.
Well, it's not necessarily when I'm right, and it's you're definitely not going to do the paperwork when. You're right. Okay.
Because at some point, we need an as-built for a road acceptance plan. But, you know,
I think
you may not be able to. It's just the sequence. Frankly, I've never heard of that. But you're going to hold up the certificate of occupancy for the certificate of compliance.
I think Chuck is right. And the building department is going to require an as-built plan to receive an occupancy permit. But I think Chuck's talking about an as-built plan for an individual lot. Not 1, 2, 3, or 4, not an as-built plan for the entire project.
Well, specify that.
Is that what you're thinking, Chuck?
Oh, are you going to come in for individual occupancies?
They'd have to.
Yeah.
Not everything all at once? They don't have to.
These are going to be built separately. They're not part of this application.
It's possible that one will be ready.
Yeah.
And we've done it lot by lot on plenty of other jobs.
This works. We've done it with everybody. We've done it with Al. I mean, everyone's been doing this
Bill,
for years.
I think this covers the lot by lot scenario.
And I don't understand why that.
Add in for a specific lot.
Where would you like to? Could you?
Shall not sign off. In addition.
Can I make a suggestion? Since you got rid of independent and said, you said trust me. You'll trust us in return on this one.
If I look at the next page and I see, or at the end, and I see what your requirements are for a certificate of compliance, you want as-built surveys. No, you're asking for a lot of stuff that is not going to be ready or appropriate at the time of the first CO. So I'm just trying to clarify that so we don't have that issue.
So let's come back and let's look at those items then, and let's come back to this.
Okay.
because...
Well, all, I think if we just handle that, the administration will not sign off on a CO unless the commission has received required paperwork for a certificate of compliance for that individual lot. I'm only asking for a CO on lot two. Lot three and four may not even have grass cover on it, so how can I ask for a certificate of compliance?
Chuck, don't you, isn't that usually a partial when you do that? Or are we not doing partials anymore?
Well, it would be a partial if he's only asking for one out of
right.
this whole application. So it would be a partial.
Yeah. So it's okay to...
Is there any work that is being required for this project that isn't associated with a lot?
Yeah, the roadway.
Roadway. So there's going to be, even for that...
It's all tied into one.
So the roadway is divided up among each lot?
No, the
that's
whole
part
project
of this application.
Okay. So does this stipulation apply for the road as well?
No. That's not...
Well, the way it's written, it does.
That's not the way it works.
I guess I'm trying to see this whole project through, and does
right.
this one sentence only affect... Lots, but leaves out
I think what we're trying to do, I think what he wants to make sure that he gets to, if he sells a piece of property, he wants to be able to occupy it
right.
without receiving a full
certificate
of compliance for the entire project. He's not going to be ready
because
for
he
that.
Won't the replication.
So he wants to make sure that he can receive that partial certificate of compliance. And the plans that I think we're talking about, Bill, are required by the building department. So.
So if we do, just hypothetically, just playing this out, if we did grant occupancy for, let's say, the furthest lot two, the one, the house right at the end, so we grant occupancy for that, but we have not granted certificate of compliance for the roadway.
Right.
And now somebody is driving in and out of that house and potentially if there's a problem with the roadway or if there's a problem with roadway drainage, potentially making a situation more difficult to fix, or do you know what I mean? It's
yeah,
like potential complications.
It's already been established, I think Chuck will tell you, through higher ups and planning and building. They don't want us to hold up individual occupancy permits on houses because of orders and conditions for the specific reason, because some of them are on 2 and 3 year monitoring. So just have to check issues a parcel.
Balances. We're just
yeah, there's other checks and balances. Chuck issues a parcel on every certificate of occupancy that's requested. That's the way it's been done for quite a while.
So Bill, what is your suggested language?
I think you nailed it. What? For certificate of compliance on the lot for which the occupancy permit is requested.
Are you all set with that, Chuck?
You know, I don't know. I don't know what the difference is. It's maybe it's too late. I'll write it down, and it's worked for everybody else for forever. We're really only talking about nothing because they have to do an as-built plan, and this doesn't matter, but, you know, there's only one piece of paper that needs to be filled out outside of what already needs to be done by their engineer anyways for the building department.
I don't see the downfall in it, and if Bill has tricked us in some way, it will never get in there again.
Oh,
so.
I can never trick you guys.
Most of us, but not Anika.
Could you repeat that one more?
It just was on the lot for which the certificate of occupancy is being requested. In other words, you want to make sure the LID is good, you may want to kill me, but even then, suppose there's construction and we want a CO in November and we can't get grass to grow. Are you going to give me an occupancy when grass isn't growing? That's the problem. We may ask for a CO at a time when the project can't be completed. And are you going to hold up the CO until next June when grass is growing?
No, that's why we asked for the paperwork, and that's what this town has decided
on. It's just a matter of, if I submit the paperwork and you're not going to hold it up as long as the paperwork's in, then that's fine.
And that's what we've done in the past for everybody. There's countless examples of that.
We're over this?
Yep.
I didn't write anything down. I'm not changing it. Sounds like.
I'm done.
You sure? Because we can go.
So, I have a change.
Okay.
Last page where it says the bond, like to insert some language.
Sure.
If we remove the word independent environmental monitor, we double the bond. I'm just joking,
all right? Did fade. No, I saw the look.
So anyways, but we do have to talk about the bond. I got you to turn to the last page. I just said start thinking about it over the week. It's $20,000 on... It's a lot of work. There's a lot of work in that stream. You gotta think about that, the plants and whatnot. I don't think I've ever seen one in this town more for conservation more than 20,000, even with the ARC site. But it didn't get them to do the work we wanted to.
That would have been independent monitor.
Yeah.
That wasn't independent over there. That's the one why we want an independent monitor. That was the buddy-buddy system over there. Didn't help us.
Okay. So if nobody has any issues with this or conditions, are we ready to approve the order of conditions?
I move we approve the order of conditions as drafted and discussed tonight.
I second.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, what are you here for?
Entertainment?
No.
Miss Happy.
Yes. For
22
Bachelor Road.
Okay.
Oh, that's when I do something, right? Sorry.
On Lowell Street, we're going to make the changes. When are we going to get to sign it?
Do you have a form to sign? Just a single signature page?
I do have a form. If I didn't bring... Oh, I do. All right.
We could sign the signature page, and he can finish the forms.
You going to trust him with it?
I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to make the changes that are on it and pray.
Independence going right back in.
Desk when you showed
this.
Up.
That's
so.
Oh.
Yeah, 22 pasture.
My job.
That was in a previous package.
What
were
we talking about?
So,
yeah, the sunroom in the front. All the way in the front.
This?
Yep.
This?
You know, yes.
I've never met her and I feel like I've
never met her. Oh, I know where this is. This is the one with the thing in the next door neighbor has. The fun in the front yard.
Second business going on to help pay for that cost.
Is this the one with the dog? Thank you.
No, I thought this was the one with like the wetland in the front yard.
Yeah, on the side yard, in
the
next door.
The neighbor's house.
Yes. Yeah. Not your house.
Yeah.
Had the fox den in the way back yard.
Yes. There was a pool in the back. Pool in the backyard, drainage channel going right, real long property going right.
This is,
right, this was a while ago. A couple, 5 months ago, maybe.
And it's a drain. Is it still in the buffer?
I guess so, yes.
What's the question? I'm sorry.
We haven't started yet. We're still trying to figure out where we are.
We're at 22 Pasture Road.
That's
the house.
Yep. Okay, I know where we are. Yep.
All right.
It's the old sun.
Do you, Anthony? Do you wanna
yes.
do this? Sure.
So, where that greenhouse is there, we had proposed in the beginning to completely get rid of it, backfill it. Once I took that down, I realized that it was sitting on a full foundation, footing underneath. Everything was fine. Everything is, you know, gone so much. We have the addition going in the back, and everything's great. And every time I walk by that foundation, I say to myself, it's killing me to just crush it and get rid of it. And it would make a perfect office for downstairs for us, for like a family office. And what we would essentially do is that window that's up there, we have the window already. We would just take it. We were going to bring that gable out and extend our living room a whole 19 feet. So we would essentially cantilever over this full foundation. It was approved by Glenn, bringing the wall out even with the outside wall into the edge of the front door. And then we still have the proposed porch and everything that we originally had. We're gonna just kind of tie it in somehow as we go along.
Okay, so it's a second story full build out?
Yes.
With supports under the existing unbuilt foundation.
It's going to sit
and
almost,
additional
yes.
footings?
Yes, additional footings. Yep.
To support the house exterior
walls? It's going to sit on the foundation, the existing full foundation that's there. And then as the part that cantilevers up, it's 3 feet on each side, they'll sit on footings.
And the bottom of the first floor is going to be?
Office.
So you're proposing two big foots?
Yes.
That's it?
Yeah.
Yes. Right here.
Yeah.
There and there.
Is the extension where the big foots are, is that going to be incorporated into the office or no? That's
no.
going to be open.
It's going to, well, it'll essentially be dead space. I was going to hopefully maybe get some shelving or something in there for the office for like, you know,
yep.
coffee printer or whatever.
Do you know if you're within the aquifer protection district?
I don't believe that I am.
Because that's additional.
Where's the drainage for this addition going? Existing?
Yes. We don't have anything for the front. We had put, and it's already in place, there's a recharge in the back for the addition that we proposed a few months back.
Which took up more water than the additional space you were...
We actually reduced the size of the addition. We were going to go much bigger in the back.
Mm-hmm.
Everything just financially. So we brought everything back. So it would be that space again. Every time I go back there, I look at it, and I actually think that it will give the house a little bit of that appeal from a typical super entry house, kind of give it that little bit of character to it that I'm hoping to get.
So Chuck, this is the previous plan.
Yes, this is okay. Yes, this is the previous. I have with me here, no one, it's not 26, it's 20 by 14, and then 22, 18 by 22.
Is that office going to have a door, an access?
Yes, there's an existing opening now that used to go up to that greenhouse where she had
but
a plan.
From that office outside?
No.
So that's going to be totally enclosed. And
yes.
There's going
to
be no
well, we
had
proposed
exit.
In the beginning is where that door is now to go into that
right.
space. We're going to put a window there.
Yeah.
And we're just going to, if we can, just take it, put it in front of the house now. If we get it moved to.
I think it's a good idea.
So what is the projection now for that?
Size of it?
Yeah. How much is it?
8 foot
no.
6 off, which it's now. It's 8'4"2",
yep.
So it's exactly the same, and then it's 19 feet long. So we're going to cantilever over this 3 feet to bring it straight out, and then our living room is right here. So we would bring this out so we get a full extension of the living room, because if we don't, furniture and placement is...
So you're basically adding a net area of approximately 4'6" by 8 feet of roof area over what was there in the past.
Yes. Actually, there was a sunroom there.
No, it's just adding. He's adding on either side.
Net increase.
About 8 feet.
It's
a net increase of about...
It's a pretty small net increase.
But there's a gable up there now. We were just going to extend it.
And the back is small.
And the back is small. So it's less impervious area than was on the original plan.
Exactly.
And if I recall correctly, the original plan, you were infiltrating more rainwater post-construction than the house was introducing into the ground today. So you're still doing that. It's still a better project tomorrow than it is. I'm fine with it.
Yeah. Yes. I would make a motion to approve the plan, minor modification as submitted.
Second.
Well, I just want an environmental monitor on this, though.
Yeah. I was just going to say,
do you have any other concerns?
No. I'm going to hire Bill if you don't mind.
Make sure you check the resume.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Chuck, did you get the vote?
No, I didn't. Trying to focus.
Chuck's gone for the night.
I'm gone.
Misha Moon has great martinis.
They do.
Do you mind?
Apparently.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you very much. So I can take this to Glenn.
What's the process for?
He'll sign off.
Okay.
So let's just sign off. Tell him it's okay. I already told him that pretty much be all right.
Okay. So I can go in tomorrow, or does it take you several
months? No, it doesn't. Tomorrow will be fine.
Okay, great.
I thought you did.
Okay, guys. Thank you for your time.
You too. Thank you.
Can I second it?
Okay. So a certificate of compliance for 26 Nelson Ave. We're still waiting for paperwork. It's a certificate of compliance, right?
Yeah.
And then Artist Senior Living Center. Chuck wants to wait till spring. We've got more vegetation growing. Take a look at the site. And then 44 Roma Lane, we discussed before, has been rescheduled for April 12th at 10.
Right.
No emergency permits, and we approved the bills, and we approved one of the minutes.
Yeah, the other one's not ready.
Yep. Any other business? Hearing none? Meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everyone.